The communities living on the riverbank of Dole Kaina and its twin town of Dole Faransi in Niger Republic, displacing hundreds of families. Governor Abubakar Atiku Bagudu, who directed the immediate evacuation of the victims to safer location, ordered for provision of food items, medical facilities, households, utensils, and land for permanent settlement to avoid future occurrence. Governor Bagudu, however, pledged government commitment to cushioning the effect of the disaster on the victims to the minimal. In a related development, the governor also sympathized with the victims of the recent gastroenteritis outbreak in the state, where 11 local governments were affected. The governor acknowledged about 1,291 cases received from April to September this year, of which 31 deaths were recorded so far. Governor Bagudu commended the effort of health personnel and community leaders and all stakeholders for contributing to contain the outbreak. Brinin Kebi, Usman Abdullahi Shehu, NTA News.
Well, it is in our nature to come to the aid of those in distress. The story of the Benue flood again reaffirms that. From the federal government, NGOs, religious organizations and private citizens, help has poured in. The latest is from no other than the beggar Tiv, Tortiv the Fifth, who led the Benue Traditional Council to visit his children in distress at the Makurdi International Market. Blessing Omeche Ebute has that report.
The royal visit came as a great source of motivation to the affected persons, who were visibly happy and welcomed the Council of Chiefs. The Tortiv the Fifth, Professor James Ayate, appreciated the timely intervention of the federal and state governments in providing succor to the affected persons.
We really feel this great loss, but our role is to come and see you and continue to pray that the Almighty God does not allow this kind of thing to happen again.
Amen. He later inspected the clinic and applauded the team of medical personnel on ground. The Benue State Council of Chiefs donated 120 bags of rice to the victims at the camp. Similarly, the United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF, Enugu Field Office has donated drugs and medical kits worth millions of naira to the IDP's camp. UNICEF health specialist Dr. Ifeanyi Anyanwu, who made the donation, said it is to forestall the outbreak of any disease and cater for the immediate health needs of inmates. UNICEF has also donated storage capacity tanks and sunk a borehole at the IDP's camp. In Makurdi, Blessing Omeche Ebute, NTA News.
Thank you. I'm now being joined in the studio by Mustafa Mehaja, the Director General of NEMA. We're glad to have you in the studio.
Thank you.
Now, it's very clear that there's a looming flood incident with the increase of water inflow from the Niger River upstream. The orange alert was, reached just about a week ago. Are we in the red alert? And if so, what's the implication of that?
Well, it is not yet red.
Okay.
But on the 1st of September, the Niger Basin Authority and intergovernment organization in West Africa aims to foster cooperation in managing and developing the resources of the basin of the River Niger shows that the yellow alert was reached. Mm-hmm. And it was fast increasing up to on 7th September when it reaches the orange mm-hmm. alert level, which is the second last before the red. In addition, Nigerian Hydrological Service Agency confirmed that Jeba and Kayenji dams have started to release water because they are full capacity and in anticipation of the possible release from Niger Republic.
Okay.
As of 13 September 2017, NISA's measuring equipment downstream of the confluence point in Lokoja is 9.36 meters. Mm. This is worrisome because the value is about to be the same as that of 13 September 2012, when the country witnessed the worst devastating flood in recent times. There is potent danger for the state of Kebbi Niger, Kogi, Delta, Rivers, Imo, and Bielsa. For all of the above, should there be the threat become a reality, the result will be catastrophic.
Okay.
The consequences of which may necessitate declaration of national disaster.
Okay, in view of, you know, these devastating floods, you know, are imminent, what preemptive plans are being put in place, especially for those states, you know, that are likely to face, you know, the impact of the increase of flow of water?
Severally, issues of warning after the March forecast released by the Hydrological Service, a lot of campaigns, sensitization and awareness campaign has been going on through NEMA and other stakeholders. We held today flood coordination forum meeting whereby we assess the level of our preparedness.
Okay.
Further meetings and consultations to provide necessary preparedness that we require to forestall any eventualities from in case the disasters eventually happens. The states are therefore called, using this opportunity, they are called upon to step up the preparedness activities, which includes, for those states that have not identified the community vulnerable to the flood in their states, identify high grounds where people can be evacuated, and begins evacuation immediately.
Okay.
NEMA is adequately prepared to provide the needed coordination to set off all the camps necessary to assist the state in doing so. This is why we met today, and we are going to visit in the subsequent days all the affected states to ensure that the level of preparedness needed to prepare us against any eventualities should the disaster grows to the national level. We don't pray for that.
Thank you very much, Director General of NEMA, Mustafa Mehaja. And moving on to other news of the day. The federal government has ordered a thorough investigation of the past management officials of the Joint Admissions and Matriculation Board, as well as NIMASA, in a deliberate attempt towards recovering the huge public funds allegedly diverted or mismanaged over the years. The Minister of Finance, Kemi Adeosu, who announced this while briefing journalists after the Federal Executive Council meeting, said shady deals in all other agencies of government are also to be probed in the renewed onslaught against corruption. State House correspondent Adebosambo reports on this and other resolutions of the Council today.
With President Muhammadu Buhari presiding, the Federal Executive Council critically examined the various fiscal initiatives being pursued towards drawing cost savings and efficiency in government for the enhancement of public good. Finance Minister Kemi Adeosun said with the plucking of leakages in the system, various agencies of government have reported very significant increase in the accruals paid into the Consolidated Revenue Fund. Where was such monies going to in the past? This is what the Buhari administration is now determined to find out.
The highest amount that JAM has ever remitted into the Consolidated Revenue Fund before this management was 3 million naira. This year, so far they have done 5 billion. And the Minister of Education reported that they have an additional 3 billion that they're ready to remit, which will take this year's figure alone to 8 billion. Now, they have not increased their charges, they have not increased their fees. So the question that FEC and council members were asking is, where was all this money before? So the directive was given that we must call those who were the heads of those agencies and similar ones to account. And that's the direction that we've been given, and that's what we intend to do. And it's a similar story with other agencies. These are the leakages which we have now come in and we're blocking. And of course, this is the money that in the Consolidated Revenue Fund is now being applied to the projects that are really needed to get the economy moving. That's the money that, you know, that's missing, that really has led us to the position that we're in. It's the grand scale looting that really this administration has has come in to address.
The council was also briefed on the second quarter National Bureau of Statistics results, now in the public domain, describing as encouraging the GDP growth rate after continued contraction for five quarters.
It indicates that we're going in the right direction. And also, we're particularly encouraged by the fact that agriculture continues to grow by 3.01%, and that industry, which had not grown for nine quarters since 2014, had been contracting. That means that the policies of the government have succeeded in stopping the slide. So as a cabinet, we recommitted ourselves to full implementation of the Economic Recovery and Growth Plan so that Nigerians can feel the full impact of the growth.
We've released 1.3 trillion last year in capital. No matter where you drive in this country, unless you're a dishonest person, you will see massive road projects going on. That's facilitating agriculture. That's facilitating solid minerals. That's facilitating manufacturing. It's about getting every part of the country, every single nook and cranny of the country, active and productive. And to do that, you need infrastructure. And we believe if we continue with this path, this trajectory, not only will we stay permanently out of recession, but more importantly, we will have a positive and growing economy that works for all Nigerians, which is our aim.
Members also discussed the incidences of flood in parts of the country, with the Minister of Water Resources, Suleiman Adamu, telling them the implications of the yellow alert activated in Niger Republic following the rising level of River Niger in the neighboring country.
That gave us an indication that there is going to be a lot more flow into the River Niger as go downstream towards Kainji, Jeba, and of course, by the time you come to the confluence at Lokoja, the situation is compounded because we're already aware of the flood situation in Benue. For now, there is no cause for alarm, but like I say, we are monitoring the situation. The most important thing is that we cannot stop the flooding, but we can provide early warning and ensure that we take effective measures to reduce loss of property and loss of lives.
The Federal Executive Council also approved that Nigeria joins the Africa Trade Insurance Agency towards providing risk guarantee for exporters from Nigeria as well as private investors coming into the country. From the State House, Adamu Sambu, NTA News.
Many thanks, Adamu. Now, if we all agree, quality education translates to development and qualitative life for the people, then standards in the educational sector should not be compromised. And so when JAMB lowered the cutoff point for entry into universities to 120, of course, there is bound to be reaction. And it came, it sure came. Ola Nkojo entered the ongoing fray and seeks answers to some of the contending issues.
The Joint Admissions and Matriculation Board, JAMB, announced the cutoff mark for universities, polytechnics, colleges of education and innovative enterprising institutions at a meeting that had those who matter in tertiary education in the country.
The cutoff is 120. Universities that are chosen 120 is free to admit candidates from 120 above.
That pronouncement of a minimum 120 has, however, generated reactions. Although there was due consultation with the heads of various institutions who came up with the consensus.
JAMB wrote to all the tertiary institutions asking them to come up with the cutoff mark that they believe is good enough for them.
Views after the pronouncement were divergent.
It is an abuse to educational standard because as at the time we were writing JAMB one time, the cutoff mark is high.
Not really good. It does not even make the students even like make more effort to just read less, just get the 120.
It's a very good option. 120 should be okay.
Now, of what implication is this on Nigeria education?
How do we interpret education as a nation? Is it just a process through which you get a certificate? Have we reduced education to a mere certificate mill where we certify people who can add value to our society? This is even actually less than 40% of the score. Which school in the world gives somebody a pass mark on the basis of 30% or less?
Admissions into public degree awarding institutions for the 2017 UTME will end on 15th of January 2018, while that of private institutions last till January 31st, 2018. Also, decisions of first choice candidates by universities will end in October 15, 2017, while for second choice candidates is December 15, after which the remaining students will be available for other institutions to the last day of January 2018. More than 1.7 million candidates applied to study various courses in tertiary institutions across the country in 2017. In Abuja, Olainka Ojo, NTA News.
And like the nickname of one model of a popular automobile, discussion continues. The arguments for and against the JAM cutoff mark continued on NTA Good Morning Nigeria show, with guests emphasizing the quality and standards must not be compromised in the nation's educational sector. Omotola Omojola has that report.
The controversy that greeted the announcement by the Joint Admissions and Matriculation Board's resolution of 120 as a cutoff mark for university admissions has refused to die down, with many opposing it while some embrace it. Guests on Good Morning Nigeria also had divergent opinions. While some see it as soft landing for universities with few applicants and an avenue for expanding the scope for more candidates seeking tertiary education, others are strongly of the opinion that the development will reduce the quality of education in Nigeria.
We're talking about access to these universities. What sense does it make that you have an examination where it is supposed to be a qualifying examination, and at the end of the day you say it is only 10% of the candidates that can be admitted?
200 has been something reasonable. 200 is 50%, because it's 200 over 400.
The signal you send to the outside world is that you are now taking weak students into your system.
There are some students who enter the university with a very high mark, and in the course of their studies they are not very helpful, they are not very strong. And those who enter the university with low marks will be very, very strong, you know, at the end of the day.
The disparity in the cutoff marks of universities and polytechnics, despite federal government stance on eliminating the dichotomy between the two, also came up, even as guests also highlighted the long-term effect on quality of teachers that will be produced.
You have put the cutoff mark for colleges of education at 100. That's precisely 25%. And you are talking about quality teachers. How are you going to get quality teachers out of the system?
If we do not get education right, we will never get anything right in this country. And we cannot do that by lowering standards.
The need to tackle the issues from the primary and secondary levels were also noted to aid performance. In Abuja, Omotola Omojola, NTA News.
Well, issues of quality and standards in our schools seems to be spreading like wildfire, and I'm liking it. In River State, 40 private schools have been closed down for failure to comply with standards and operational guidelines laid down by the state government. Oneginye Fineface reports that the State Ministry of Education has commenced enforcement of the closure as the 2017-2018 academic year begins.
Close by officials of the State Ministry of Education had visible signs of substandard environment. Beyond the attractive signages, the interiors of some of the schools lacked the basic requirements to qualify for conducive learning and teaching. Dirty classrooms, leaking roofs, overly tight and stuffy classrooms and hallways, courtyards littered with debris, among other unhealthy features, characterize the environment of the closed schools.
If the government feels that some schools are substandard and they set out a proper criteria for those schools and those schools do not meet the criteria, I think in the best interest of the society at large, the government can go ahead and should go ahead to shut such schools down.
If any of them removes our sticker, of course, the law will take its course on them. They will be prosecuted, because I mean, you can't open a school illegally and operate in River State.
While commending the state government for going on to shut down substandard schools in the state,
Some respondents are of the opinion that caution should be applied to ensure that students are not left out of school because their parents are unable to transfer them from the non-approved to approved public and private schools in the state.
I think what the government should do is to encourage them, assist them, prompt them up to meet the required standard instead of outrightly shutting down their schools.
The closure of unapproved schools is coming after the expiration of the grace period given to proprietors of private schools by the state government to upgrade their environment, provide relevant learning and teaching materials to meet the set standards of operation. In Port Harcourt, Onengie Fineface, NTA.
And still talking education, science teachers across the country can now earn extra money while carrying out their normal duties. This is courtesy of a reality show, The Science Teacher's Game. The game, powered by Mr. Labs, was unveiled in Lagos. Joy Ken Abakoya has the details.
Game, according to the initiator, is aimed at addressing the loopholes in science education by encouraging practicals in laboratories, which is the real essence of science. The game will provide an opportunity for teachers and students across the country to showcase their science experiments through an online portal and get paid.
When you register for free, you bring on board your students in SS1, SS2, and SS3, depending on which classes you are teaching. Follow the processes, schedule your practicals, perform your practicals, submit your practicals, and you start earning your money.
The organizer says season one of the game, which starts this September, will culminate in a reality show at the end of the school season in 2018.
We're going to give award to the best science teachers and students, their school head teachers and principals, and even the school itself. Just go online, go to www.asspppaa.com.
It's an educational competition that's open to secondary schools across Nigeria, both public and private schools, and there's a lot of prizes up for grabs. I mean, we are talking about 60 million naira cash prize, IVM cars, all expense paid trips to Dubai.
Biology, chemistry and physics teachers nationwide are expected to log on to www.aspa.com to register for free. In Lagos, Joy Ken Abakoya, NTA News.
The River State Police Command says it has arrested 32 members of the indigenous people of Biafra, IPOB, in connection with the violence that erupted in Oyigbo, a border town between Imo and River States yesterday, which resulted in the death of a police sergeant and burning of houses. Kingsley Amajiri has that report.
The State Police Commissioner Ahmed said 20 persons were injured. A police sergeant, Stephen Daniel, lost his life with two police patrol vehicles burnt by the rampaging group.
The command was awakened to yet another sad incident today at about 00:10 hours, where some daredevil IPOB members regrouped and launched a surprise attack on the mobile policeman station at Oyibo Junction, killing a police sergeant identified as Sergeant Stephen Daniel, attached to 19 PMF, injuring two and set a patrol vehicle ablaze.
NTA News gathered that the driver of one of the burnt patrol vehicles, Inspector Imaku Ochochi, was badly injured. The police commissioner, however, said the situation has been brought under control as men of the command has been deployed to the area to maintain law and order. In Port Harcourt, Kingsley Amajiri, NTA News.
In the meantime, socio-economic activities have gradually returned to Aba, the commercial hub of Abia State, after skirmishes in some parts of the city on Tuesday. Priye Frederick, who visited some areas of the town to ascertain the level of normalcy, now reports.
Sit round the streets and marketplaces like the new market and shopping center. Residents and traders were seen going about their daily business activities without fear of intimidation or molestation from any group.
Not really, not bad. Everything is moving fine this morning, so we thank God for that. So yesterday we thought maybe what happened yesterday would have you know, continue today. But thank God that everything is moving smoothly. No fighting, no riot.
We are appealing to the government, both federal and the state government, to come to our aid to help us so that our business will be moving.
A visit to some motor parks in the metropolis speak for itself, as commuters were seen boarding vehicles to their various destinations. Some residents who spoke on the present situation of things in the city lauded the state government for swinging into action by declaring a three-day curfew from 12 September to 14 September 2017 to calm tension in the city, as residents were advised to remain law-abiding and carry on their lawful business without fear.
What we are passing through last night by the road around from 6, you will not be seen any motor again because of the announcement by the governor. From that, after 6, there will be no, there's no any other motor again.
We use this opportunity to beg the populace of Aba on the need for peaceful coexistence among various tribes. Without peace, there will be no progress, there will be no development. Peaceful atmosphere is the panacea to development.
It will be remembered that the commercial city of Aba witnessed some security challenges in the early hours of Tuesday, thereby forcing residents to close down their businesses and return home for fear of not being caught in the middle of the crisis in town. In Aba, Pray Frederick, NTA News.
And I'm now being joined in the studio by Brigadier General Sani Usman, the Director of Army Public Relations, to tell us more about the military IPOP crisis. It's good to have you join me in the studio.
Good evening and thank you for having me.
Yeah, now the Nigerian Army recently moved some war arsenal to the southeast. What is the mission of the Army in that area?
Actually, do you really actually call them war arsenals? As you are quite aware, actually, we are embarking on a field training exercise, which is nicknamed Egweke, and literally translated is a Python dance. It's a continuation of an exercise that we had late last year, between November and December 2016. Okay. You know, it's aimed at exercising the troops of 82 Division to enhance their proficiency in internal security duties, and at the same time also to address security challenges of kidnapping, armed robbery that are associated with the Ember period in that particular region of the country. Remember, again, we have had similar exercise, Harbin Kunama 2, within the northwest and north central part of this country in April this year. And we are also, as soon as we are done with exercise Egweke, we are embarking on exercise Crocodile Smile 2. This time around, it will go beyond the south-south part of the country to southwest also, exercising 3 divisions. The whole essence is to enhance the proficiency of our troops. So people have nothing to fear, because it's something that we have been doing just to enhance our professional skills.
Well, a particular incident involving the army and some residents of Aba led to a certain crisis that was reported in the media. What exactly happened?
Well, I think that information is not correct. But okay, what really happened is that some miscreants took undue advantage of the security challenges that were emanated as a result of misunderstanding among some youth groups and the military in Umuahia here, not even in Aba. Okay. So they decided to molest some people and loot some shops. But thankfully, the proactive aspect, I mean, the proactiveness of the state governor by, you know, nipping it in the bud and declaring a curfew, 6 to 6 curfew. And even today, the general officer commanding 82 Division, along with the deputy governor of IBS State, as well as the commissioner of police and the 14th Brigade commander, they were at Isia Langwa, Umuahia, and Aba itself. And as you can see, Numeracy has returned, and they have discussed and interfaced with the community, including traditional rulers also. So it is not correct to say there was a skirmish between soldiers and some people in Aba. There wasn't anything like that.
Okay, so but that has unfortunately generated, you know, some issues among the communities there. So what is the military doing to create awareness, you know, to make people there aware that...
Yes, it's just that it's so unfortunate some people, for whatever reason, and some of them out of ignorance, actually they misconstrued the essence of the field training exercise. And to answer your question, actually, we've been doing a lot, because last week, Friday, the Chief of Training and Operations, Major General David Amadou, addressed a press conference, the press, and issued a statement about the essence of that exercise. This was followed up with the issuance of telephone numbers and as well as email addresses in case if there were issues. Gradually, and of course, the various formation commanders are reaching out to the host communities in which some of these exercises are going to take place. And in any case, the exercise is going to take place within the five states of that make up the Southeast geopolitical zone of the country. And the Department of Civil Military Affairs is also reaching out to the host community, and a lot of activities. It's just that some people, for whatever reason, they were so impatient, they did not ask a question, and they just jump into conclusion, saying all sort of things. We meant well, and it's for the benefit of the community. And if I may add there, you know, it was because of the relevance of exercise Python dance of last year. That was why that Egueku exercise has to take place this year. And it was a response to the yearning of the host community that instead of calling it Python dance, we should also reflect the cultural realities of that society, calling it Egueku. The whole essence is to make sure the society is secure, especially during the Emba period. You know, that part of the country is associated with kidnapping, armed robbery, especially at this period in time. And in fact, that is what has informed the Nigerian army to establish the 14th Brigade in Ohafia. There's so many other things.
Thank you very much, Brigadier General Sani Usman, for that insight. Still ahead of the news, you can watch this news live online via the NTA mobile app, which you can download on your Android device at the Google Play Store or at the Apple Store if you use devices with iOS. Up ahead, Federal High Court gets more judges as correspondent explores implications of local government autonomy. That's when we return after the break. Join us again.
From 1967 to 1970, Nigeria went through a horrifying civil war. It didn't matter who was wrong or right. Everybody suffered. Those who fought that war say it should never happen again.
So a lot of people will say, but you were leading the first one. Yes, I led the first one. I don't think a second one is necessary. We should have learned from that first one. Otherwise, the dead would have been to no avail. Could all have been in vain.
The words of our elders are full of wisdom.
This is a public service announcement brought to you by NTA.
Nigeria is a strong emerging world economy with a population of over 170 million people. With the diligent work of the Standards Organization of Nigeria, in line with the federal government's economic diversification agenda, SON has put in place accredited laboratories to ensure that made in Nigeria products meet international standards and ready for export. SON regularly conducts products registration, certifications, factory inspections, monitoring, a metrology laboratory to get accurate measurements, while SONCAP checks the conformity of imported products and the SON Legal Act to prosecute offenders. Don't sell and don't buy substandard products. Before you buy, look well, well. See something, say something, or call these numbers. SON, improving life through standards.
Availability. Check. Confidentiality. Check. Integrity. Check. Transformation in action. The 6 years of Governor Abdulaziz Abubakar Jari in Zamfara State clearly manifest good governance and foresight. In fact, transforming the agrarian state to the promised land.
Welcome to Zamfara, a state being governed by a visionary and dynamic leader whose magic finger is touching every aspect of human lives. No wonder Abdulaziz Yari is being referred as agent of Buhari's change mantra. Yari is bringing development closer to the Zamfara people and the nation at large. Zamfara, the pride of the nation. This message is brought to you by Iowa Media Group.
Come, join us celebrate God's faithfulness as we honor His grace, the Most Reverend Dr. Musa Pantifilibus, Archbishop of the Lutheran Church of Christ in Nigeria, who has been elected President of the Lutheran World Federation. A grand reception in his honor will be chaired by Reverend Dr. Caleb Ahima, taken President. Special guest of honor, His Excellency Professor Yemi Osibanjo, Vice President, Federal Republic of Nigeria. Guest of honor, Right Honorable Yakubu Dogara, Speaker, House of Representatives. Governor Darius Ishaku of Taraba State, Governor Samuel Otom Benue State, Governor Simon Lalong Plateau, Host Governor Mohammed Jibrila of Adamawa State, while His Grace, the Most Reverend Dr. Benjamin Kwashi, Archbishop of Province of Jos Anglican Communion, is keynote speaker. Date, Saturday, 16 September 2017, time, 10 a.m. Venue, Mahmoud Ribadu Square, Jumeta Yola. Come and rejoice with the Lutheran family.
There is a reason Africa is called the new frontier. What was once potential is now an opportunity ready to be seized. Once revered for our resources, today's wealth lies in our people. People who build the cities that shape the future. People who know an idea in one place means business in another. A generation for whom technology means there are no borders, no boundaries. We are the new lions in a brave new world, kings of the urban jungle. And there's a bank that puts the world in our pocket and the future in our hands. UBA, Africa's global bank.
These is to inform all distinguished senators and honorable members of the National Assembly of the Federal Republic of Nigeria that the resumption date of both houses in plenary has been rescheduled from Tuesday, 19th September to Tuesday, 26th September 2017. All distinguished senators and honorable members are by this notice requested to resume sitting in plenary on Tuesday, 26th September 2017 by 10 a.m. prompt, please. M.A. Sani Omoluri, Clerk to the National Assembly. Announcer.
We want to buy Indomie noodles.
Four bags, please.
Yo, what?
This is not my Indomie.
Please, sir, if it's not Indomie, don't call it Indomie.
Sir, the taste is the difference. The difference is in the taste. That's why my brothers, my mommy, my daddy, and I all enjoy our delicious, so very delicious Indomie noodles. The difference is the taste.
Taste is the difference.
Yes, difference is in the taste. Nothing tastes like my Indomie.
Indomie noodles, tasty nutrition, good for you.
Nigerian police now operates in the best international practices of policing. Do you know that the Nigerian police has been restructured to be more accountable and responsive to all your security challenges? Now, what the police demand from you is your trust, your collaborative efforts by providing necessary information about criminals and their activities in your neighborhood. Be vigilant to achieve our creed as we promise. We shall police the country based on international core values of policing with integrity. We shall ensure that rule of law prevails in our actions and activities. We shall respect diversity, display courage, show compassion, and demonstrate professionalism. We shall operate within the principle of democratic policing. We shall shun corruption, and we shall make Nigeria safer and secured under the leadership of IGP Ibrahim Otum Idris. Let the wind of change blowing across the country chase away crime for the benefit of our society. Yes, the Nigerian police says this change must come with peace and tranquility. This message was brought to you by the Public Relations Department of the Nigerian Police Force.
If you're just tuning in, you're on to NTA News Extra on the network service of the NTA. We begin with the judiciary. If you have ever had to sit through a court session, you will agree the judge's gray hair is not just wisdom alone. No wonder even the wigs lawyers use are gray too. The work, understandably, is much and must be done diligently so that justice is not miscarried. And so when 10 more judges are injected into the Federal High Court, the workload of the others will be reduced. This is the cheering news the Chief Justice of Nigeria gave in a message to the opening of the 2017 Annual Conference of Judges of the Federal High Court in Abuja. Judiciary correspondent Femi Okewo tells us more.
The Federal High Court has divisions in all the 36 states of the Federation, and with a total of 80 judges, the case docket of each of the judges runs between 500 to 1,000 cases per judge. This, according to the Chief Judge of the Federal High Court, Justice Ibrahim Auta, is outrageously high and does not make for high productivity. The court therefore applied for 20 more judges, out of which 10 have now been granted.
The judiciary remains committed in its responsibility towards the fight to tackle corruption as spearheaded by the federal government. I seize this opportunity to urge all other stakeholders involved in the dispensation of justice to perform their own roles effectively.
This is the last year Justice Ibrahim Auta will mark as the Chief Judge of the court, as he is due to retire in a couple of days' time after attaining the statutory retirement age of 65. He says he is satisfied with the work ethics of the court.
My career in this court and my appointment as the Chief Judge has been roundly successful because of the caliber of people on the bench.
Guests speak on the benefits of the annual conference to the development of the court.
We are always plain when we gather like this. Always plain. We tell the truth to each other and then we try to do what we have taught, what we've been taught by our colleagues or what we have learned from our colleagues.
Affords the Federal High Court judges the opportunity of cross-pollinating ideas, looking at the thorny issues that may have transpired or come before them for adjudication during the year, and then see where they could improve from what they have done or correct those they have not done right.
The position of the law is the key focus of the judges when arriving at their decision, but conferences like these give them an opportunity to re-examine those positions in the light of public policy and the interest of society. In Abuja, Femi Okewu, NTA News.
Thank you, Femi. Now, with preparations towards the 2019 general elections already in progress, the Buhari Campaign Organization has added its voice, calling on Nigerians to support the call on President Muhammadu Buhari to seek a second term in office. This, the organization explained at a media briefing, is to consolidate on the gains of his administration since he assumed office in 2015. Political correspondent Abdullahi Garbabrinikudu has more on that report.
Buhari Campaign Organization is one of the major groups that supported President Muhammadu Buhari in 2015, leading to the success of the APC in the general elections. The organization expressed satisfaction on the levels of achievements recorded so far in the area of security, agricultural revolution, fight against corruption, and economic revitalization as evidence of more goodies to come under the Buhari administration. It therefore announced a plan to hold a unity rally in October this year to showcase such achievements, create awareness, and promote government policies and programs.
At that day, there are people that are coming all over. All the ethnic nationalities are coming to participate in that rally. And we have discussion with most of the key leaders of, especially Your Highness, the leaders of Afere.
There was once upon a time in Nigeria, you are afraid when you are in the hospital because bomb could explode at any moment. This is the first time, as I am talking with you, as at today, the total base income of Nigeria on this budget from January 1st, 2017 to date is 90.1% divert of oil.
With membership cutting across regional line, the Buhari campaign organization has branches in all the states of the Federation and the FCT. In Abuja, Abdullahi Garba Borinokudu, NTA News.
With the inability of the third tier of government to meet up with salary payment obligation, coupled with dwindling socio-economic development at that level, granting it autonomy has been proffered a solution to the myriads of problems confronting effective and efficient administration of local governments in Nigeria. Timothy Yusuf picks up the story from here.
In 1976, the then Olusegun Obasanjo regime carried out a reform of the local government system in Nigeria, with the outcome put in the 1979 constitution. Objectives of the reform included fostering local government autonomy, taking governance and development closer to the grassroots, creating more economic activities at the local levels, and giving that level of government access to federal allocation. Many believe that since then, local government administration has never achieved the objectives of enhancing development at the grassroots and becoming an autonomous tier of government. But instead, they became units through which Nigeria's oil wealth is shared. Till date, all efforts to give the local councils an autonomous status have failed both during military and civilian regimes. To worsen the situation, the creation of the joint state and local government account and the power of state assemblies to regulate activities of the local governments further ensured that the objective of autonomy is conclusively defeated. A ray of hope is, however, in the offing, as the opportunity, which was once rejected by the local governments themselves few years ago, is again thrown to them by the National Assembly by way of constitutional amendment.
I will do everything humanly possible to ensure that the autonomy of local government of Nigeria, inshallah, will be achieved.
Attempting to grant autonomy to local governments, according to those who know, will almost amount to having 774 states, in addition to the 36 states of the Federation. This, the Association of Local Governments of Nigeria, described as the way to go if that tier of government must justify its mandate.
When we are giving autonomy, the first frontline charge is supposed to be salary. The moment you pay salary, whatever remains, no matter how little it is, you can at least make any projects with such things.
National Assembly has done fantastically well about this.
Some states claimed to have already gone ahead by giving free hand to their local councils to operate devoid of interferences.
Niger State is, we are in a better position, because out of 25 local government, almost 15 local government were able to pay their salary after that local government autonomy.
Analysts proceed that the military had hitherto taken over power from the local councils in order to perfect their totalitarian hold on the polity. It is on this note that the current concept of local government as a tier of government is seen by many as a scam. In Abuja, Timothy Yusuf, NTA News.
The Chinese Vice Premier Wang Yong has called on developed countries